I want to pay my respects to the Kaurna people and their elders past and present. And thank you, Elizabeth and Jocelyn, for inviting me here. It's very exciting to be in your new building, this part of it, and I've just seen your stained glass windows, which really are truly beautiful. And when I was talking to Elizabeth, she was telling me about your membership growth over the last 10 years. And first she said, oh, we've had a 91% growth. And I thought, 91%? It's probably not really possible, is it? Maybe she means density, because I know there's like a high amount, you know, level of density with nurses. And then I questioned her and she said, oh no, over the last 10 years, we've gone up 91%. So I reckon that must make you the fastest growing union in the country. It must. So I'm going to talk to you about the union movement. So that's you, that's all of us, that's every single union member and their friends and their family and retired union members around the country campaign, change the rules. And what's it about? Really, it's about changing all the rules that have led to record inequality in our country. Now, of course, we always saw ourselves as the country of a fair go, of egalitarianism, but that's been eked away over time. And in particular, it's got much worse since the global economic crisis in 2007. What we've actually seen is a big shift in wealth and power to the top, and it's not been shared fairly with the rest of us. So both income inequality, so how much people earn at the top and the bottom, and wealth inequality, so how much stuff you have, has also increased. This is a very different type of society than the one that we as union members have fought for over a period of time. So really the campaign's about changing the rules that have led to this type of inequality and bringing back fairness to Australia. That's essentially what it's about. But it's important to think about, okay, how did all this happen? How did we go from having a more equal society to one that's less equal and it's getting worse? Well, really, it's because for the last 30 years, our government and governments around the world got caught up with this idea of trickle-down economics. Some people call it neoliberalism. And that has been the result. And so it started with people like Margaret Thatcher and then Ronald Reagan. And here in Australia, we had John Howard at various state levels. Some of our politicians have picked up these ideas as well. And of course, it was about the public sector being bad, about outsourcing and privatising as much as you can, and about removing all the rules that we put in, working people put in, to ensure fairness. So to take them away, and if you can, get unions out of the way as well, so that employers and the big corporations are the ones who make the decisions rather than ordinary people like us having a say over what those decisions are. And if you look at that in a really way that you're dealing with at the moment, your campaign for ratios in the aged care sector is a classic example of actually you fighting back against that whole ideology. Because that ideology, of course, would never accept the fact that nurses, that working people would say, well, there needs to be rules to make sure there's quality care for people, because they think that the only people who should be deciding those rules, of course, are the corporations or the governments that run the aged care facilities. And their logic, of course, is they've got to return profits to their shareholders. That's the way it works. And so that's the rules they're following by. And so putting in place laws that would ensure fair ratios goes totally against that whole idea that they've got, that really there should be no rules in place and that they're the ones who should be deciding things. So your campaign for ratios is essentially one part of the overall campaign to change the rules to bring back fairness, because it's about bringing back fairness, obviously, in aged care and elsewhere. So for us, when you think about it, 30 years is a long time for an experiment, isn't it? Like 30 years is a long time. So we've seen the results of it after 30 years, and the results are record inequality. And like I talked about, wealth inequality as well as income inequality, it's also led to more insecure work, because we've lost a lot of those rules that protected secure jobs. And it's also led to the fact we've now got record low wage growth, which is just, well, the economists say it's weird. They don't know what's going on. They say, well, it's meant to be that when profits go up and productivity goes up, wages just magically go up. But that seems to not be happening, because profits are going up, productivity is going up, but our wages are staying the same. And what they don't really understand is what we all know. Employers will give pay increases when the law requires them to, so if your award goes up, or if you have enough power, bargaining power, to be able to get those pay rises. And what's missing at the moment is both the laws that will increase awards and also our bargaining power. So you think about it, it's logical, isn't it? If one side over a period of time has increased their wealth and power and we've stayed the same, effectively, this has happened. And so what we need to do is change the rules to bring back balance again, to bring back fairness, to make sure we've got enough bargaining power to win these things. And you think about, okay, well, what can be done? Because sometimes, you know, you read in the press or people will say, and sometimes governments say, that nothing can be done about this because it's just natural. It's just the way things are going. We're in a global economy now and there's big multinationals and governments themselves can't really do much about all of this. We're just like in an ocean and we've been pushed around by the waves. But that's not true. I'll tell you why it's not true. Because there's two really important things that any government can do to turn around inequality. Very first is making sure that everyone pays their fair share of tax. Because if we have a system where it's just us being the ones paying tax, well then the paying for all of our services come back to all of us. And we've got a big problem at the moment because those big companies have got more and more power, they've found more and more ways to get around paying tax. So last year, it was 680 companies, big profitable companies in Australia that paid no tax. Now that's gone up this time to 732. So that's a third of all big companies aren't paying any tax. And you think, well, maybe that's right. If they're not doing very well, they're making losses, all that. No, all of these companies are making very good profits, thank you very much. What they've done is because they've got that wealth and power, they are able to spend an enormous amount of money on lawyers and tax agents and lobbyists and all of that to get out of paying it. So they'll shift their profits overseas to other places. They'll find all these other ways of making sure they can write down that so they don't end up paying anything. You think, well, that's pretty wrong, isn't it? Because all those companies use the things we're paying for. They use our roads, they use our airports, they use our schools and our hospitals. And if they don't pay tax, how can we have an equal society, a fairer society? So there's that. Then you look at the issue of individuals, and it's the same, really. So those people, like once you have enough wealth, you can basically find out how to get out of paying tax. And so the best example I've got of this is that last year, there were 62 individuals in Australia that earned $1 million in 1 year. And those 62 people paid no tax, not even the Medicare levy. And that's just crazy, isn't it? Because they earned $1 million in 1 year, yet they were able to find all the loopholes, all the ways of writing down their money, shifting things into family trusts, all the various ways that it can be done when you've got that much money to not contribute to society. So, number one, critically important thing that needs to happen is reform of our tax laws to bring back fairness, to make sure we have the money for all of us, for our schools, for our hospitals, for our community services, for all of those basic things. But at the moment, the Turnbull government is like totally committed to exactly the opposite. So this whole thing about what's left, these corporate tax cuts, which are just for the very top, those companies that really aren't paying much tax anyway, that is money, like that's $80 billion. And that's money that we would have got that we're not going to get if we give them those tax breaks. Well, how are we going to find the money to pay for our schools and hospitals if all of a sudden we lose $80 billion? And I find it interesting that this doesn't get talked too much about. Really, in the end, who will they be asking to pay? It'll be us. Of course it'll be us. So it'll either be user pays, or at some point they'll say, oh, we don't have enough money, we've got an ageing population, we've got to put up the GST. It'll be all of those things. And one of the main arguments they have for these corporate tax cuts is that we need to do it in order to be competitive. And, you know, all these other countries drop their corporate tax rates, and so ours is 30%, it's going to go down to 25%. And so we've got to do that to be competitive with them, and that all of these companies will pack up and go overseas if they can't get the lower tax rates here. What they don't talk about is that there's a headline tax rate, the 30% corporate tax rate, and the actual amount of tax that companies pay. So remember I said there was those 732 companies and didn't pay any tax? So the actual rate of pay that corporations pay in Australia is 11%, right? So that is puts us as a country right in the middle, actually in the lower part of the middle of how much tax corporations are paying. So whenever you hear anyone say, oh, we've got to do it in order to be competitive, it's not true. Like you can have a rate that says 30%, but you've got to look at what they're actually paying rather than what it says they should pay. So the real rate of tax that they're paying. The other thing they say is that, and Malcolm Turnbull says it, is look, if we have these tax cuts for these big companies, it'll lead to pay increases. And this is like classic trickle-down economics, classic trickle-down. So we give them what was going to be our money from our schools and hospitals, and we give it to those companies, and what they will do is then they'll trickle it back down to us in pay rises and in jobs. And I suppose some people might think, oh, maybe that's true. But the thing is like I said before, there's been 30 years of this experiment and it hasn't worked because you know what's happened? Is they've kept it. They've kept that money. They've not given pay raises unless the laws required it or unless their workers have had enough power to get those pay rises. There was a big hullabaloo made about Walmart, who is the biggest private sector employer in the US, after Donald Trump gave those tax breaks, big tax cuts to the big end of town. Oh, look, pay rises are happening. And they, what Walmart did, who pay people less than what is you can live on, like poverty wages, they gave them a once-off bonus. You know, a once-off bonus, it doesn't go into your base rate of pay. Next year, you still have the lower base rate of pay you're on before. No real increase to take things up over time, a once-off bonus. Well, finally, Bloomberg's, who's the big, you know, economists over in the US, have done the analysis of what's happened since those corporate tax cuts have come through, and actually wage growth has gone down. It's gone down. And because at the middle of like trickle-down economics, it's sort of like a flawed thinking, isn't it, that at some point those people will say, okay, we have enough now, and it's time to share. We're going to start sharing. Doesn't work like that, does it? The reason why employers will share or that things become fairer is when we have rules that make them do it and that they all have to play by the same rules. And so that is what our campaign's about. So the second way, so we talked about taxes, making things fairer. The second way of making society fairer and more equal is making sure that working people have strong enough rights at work to have more secure jobs and have fair pay increases. So for our campaign, we are very focused on this particular matter at the moment. Our level of insecure work in Australia is not normal. And again, some people will tell young people, look, you know, it's a great new world out there, it's so flexible, you're going to have 30 jobs in your working life and it's great, you're not going to be tied down with a horrible permanent job and that it's great, you know, get ready for that. And they say, that's just the way things are, that's the way things are going with new technology, gig economy, et cetera, et cetera. That is not true either. Out of the whole of the OECD, so that's all the developed countries around the world, so countries that are like us, we have the highest level of temporary work out of all of those countries. And now 40% of people are in insecure work, and now less than half of the population, working population, are in permanent full-time jobs. Now, it didn't used to be like that in our country. You think, well, how's that happened? It's happened because the rules that employers had to follow by were taken away or weakened over a period of time. So, for example, casual employees. We have this situation where there's plenty of casuals across our country, and I keep coming across them, who've been in the job for 20 years, working the same hours, working the same shifts all of that time, and they're a casual. Now, why does that happen? Our laws say that a casual who is whoever the employer deem is such, right? So employer can come along and say you're a casual even though you're working regular hours. Our laws used to say you're a casual if you're not working systematic and regular work. So it's pretty straightforward what we've got to do, isn't it? Bring back a definition of what a casual is so that if you're working regular hours, you get all rights like everyone else does. So there's that. There's labour hire. labour hire is being used to replace permanent workers and then to make insecure workers. The way to deal with that, the reason why employers do it usually, not always, but usually, is a way of reducing the wages bill. So if you take away that incentive and say, well, labour hire and permanent and direct employees have to be paid the same in the same conditions, well, employers will have to think, is it really worth it bringing in labour hire because I'm not going to get that incentive? That's the rule we can bring in to fix that too. Fixed-term employment. I don't know if this is an issue in your industry, but it is in a whole lot of others, right? So people have fixed-term contracts and they just roll on and on and on. And usually they end at Christmas time because they don't want to pay the annual leave, like for that time. And this happens a lot in education. And every year that person's just got a stress about whether or not their employer will grant them a new offer next year. So they have to go through that. Their family goes through that. They can't plan for the future. All of those things. In Germany, which is pretty typical of a whole lot of other countries, is there's limits on fixed-term employment. So they say you can only roll over it twice. So you can do it twice, and after that, you're in a permanent job. Again, they've got rules that stop those things happening. So there's a lot we can do to turn around insecure work. We should be aiming to halve the level of insecure work we've got in our country, because otherwise we'll have a situation where, you know, new workers, all they know is never having a sick day, never having a paid holiday, never having all of those really rights that we fought for over a period of time. So that is a key part of the rules we want changed for working people. Second part of it is to do with our bargaining power. So we say this, why shouldn't a group of workers be able to bargain? Like, why shouldn't nurses, if they chose to, be able to bargain right across the state to set the pay rate? Maybe you already do that because you're in a different system. But in a whole lot of other places, for example, childcare workers, you're in a little childcare centre, there's five of you, and you're meant to bargain with your voluntary management committee for pay increases, where actually the people who set your pay are there's a funding body. So why shouldn't childcare workers be able to bargain in a bigger group in order to get the power they need to win fair pay rises? At the moment, it's not legal for them to do so. You're only allowed to bargain at an enterprise, and enterprises have got smaller and smaller and smaller with globalisation, and our power has diminished over that period of time. We also want to make sure that people have fair rights to withdraw their labour if they need to. Now, no one wants to go on strike. Who would want to go on strike? You lose money, right? But in our country, if you do so and you don't follow every single law, so let's say something really terrible happened in your workplace. Let's say you've got a terrible bullying boss, for example. Everyone gets together and they say, well, we're not going to work with them until they're out of this workplace. You risk losing your house because you can be sued by that employer for the losses. And so that doesn't happen all the time, but it's in the back of workers' heads too. Plus you get individually fined $10,000, plus you have to lose a minimum of 4 hours' pay. Now, in most other countries, that's not the case either. It's like a fundamental human right to be able to do that when you need to. The final part of the rules, and I'm sort of giving them big themes, is to make sure that we can actually enforce the rights we've got quickly and easily. We used to have a system in our country of where the Fair Work Commission could make decisions, they could arbitrate things. John Howard took that away, and we never got that back. You know all the wage theft that we're seeing around the country with young people in cafes and everywhere and celebrity chefs and all of that. Now, why is that happening? Because there was always a bit of it, right? But why is it so big now? Well, because if you're, let's say you're a dishwasher in I don't know, George Columbaris's, you know, swank place, and you're not being paid properly, in order to get that money back, you've got to go off to the court and you've got to hire a lawyer to go to the court. Up against George's lawyer, and it's costly, it takes time, all just to get back the money that you're owed. It's probably going to cost more than that anyway. We need like a quick, easy, fair system for workers to be able to enforce their rights, because it's one thing to have rights, isn't it? Another thing to be able to enforce them, and that's basic fairness. So we need to bring back that power of the independent umpire to be able to keep employers in check so that we can enforce our rights. So there are some of the things that we believe it's necessary to turn around inequality and to make sure that we have the rights we need to ensure fairness. So how are we going to do that? How are we going to do it? Well, you have to consider this first of all. Who was it that put in, you know, the rules in the first place for the 8-hour day? Who put in the rules? Yeah. Who put in the rules for equal pay for women? Who got those? We did. who put in the rules for superannuation. So everyone got superannuation. We fought for that. We won that. I could go on and on, like every single right that made the country fair were things that we did just every day, working people. That's what we did through our unions by sticking together and just demanding these are the rules we need in order to ensure fairness. Even Medicare, which isn't a story that's told often enough. Malcolm Fraser tried to dismantle the predecessor to Medicare, Medicaid Bank Private, when he was Prime Minister. There was a national strike that our movement had, the trade union movement had, which a third of the workforce participated in the mid-70s, and he backed off doing that. If we didn't do that, there wouldn't have been that basis to be able for us to build Medicare on top of it. And then when Whitlam got elected and then when Hawke got elected, what we did as a trade union movement is said is we'd be prepared not to have a pay rise in order to get Medicare. So that all happened because we did it. Unions did it. We are the ones who gave all Australians Medicare, and we should never forget that. And so that's the type of thing that we've got to do now. I mean, no one else is going to bring back fairness to the country. We'll have to do it. Now, I feel actually really quite optimistic about this, which I'll go on about in a minute. But, you know, how do we bring this about? How does it happen? In the end, it happens through individual conversations and conversations we coordinate together. So that story I told you about trickle-down economics and how it's led to that inequality, telling people that story is important because then they have a framework for understanding, okay, how did all this happen? You know, where did we get to that point? And so that allows you then to talk about, well, we need to put in place rules that ensure, you know, fairness again, and we need to change the rules to do so. So that's having conversations, obviously, with your work colleagues, but your friends and your family and all of that. But as a trade union movement, what we're really good at is organising to do it together as well. There'll be lots of events that are going to come up over the next 12 months for sure that we'll ask people to be part of. For example, in the first weekend of September, there's a national door knock where working people all over the country are going to be involved in the biggest door knock we've ever seen to go and talk to people about Australia needing a pay rise and needing rules to put in place so that we do get fair pay rises. So be part of that. Be part of all the different workers, the teachers and the community workers, the building workers, everyone who's going to be part of that, because that's a movement, isn't it? That's how you do things. That's people power, and that's what we've got to build. And I was going to say I feel really optimistic, and I do, because for the last 30 years, it's sort of been all their way, in a way. And so lots of people just believe that, oh, well, maybe if we privatise things, you know, it will be cheaper and it will be better and all of that. And now people are saying, actually, that's not true. All those things were promised didn't happen. And people are starting to question what the orthodoxy for the last 30 years, which is good. And I can feel like the winds of change are definitely around the world. But here in Australia too, people have had enough of this type of insecure work and about the inequality that we see. And I see that also through the number of people wanting to join the union movement. So at the ACTU every Friday, I get an email from the staff telling me how many people have contacted ACTU wanting to join. And so we've had record weeks after record weeks of people wanting to join the trade union movement, which says that we're inspiring people. We're inspiring people that change is possible and they want to be part of it. The other thing that also makes me optimistic is that every single day, a random stranger will come up to me, totally random stranger, and say words to the effect of, keep going, you know, what you're doing is good. So I'll tell you, I'll finish with this, the latest one of this one. Earlier this week, I was in Sydney. My dad's sick and he's in hospital and he went to emergency. And so I flew into Sydney. I thought, I'm going to go see him while I'm here. So I drove to the hospital. I got to the emergency department, and you all know exactly, like, sometimes, you know, you go in and it was full and, like, where is he, where's my dad, walking around randomly there, and this guy's laying on a stretcher to be taken somewhere, and he sits up, he goes, Sally, and I look at him and I think, that's not my dad, and he said, good on you, keep going. So I thought, even in the emergency departments. So we'd really love you to be involved in history, because it's people that make history, it's us that make history, just by going out there and campaigning and acting together, and that would be fantastic. And if you'd like, I'm really happy to take some questions as well. Yeah? Okay. Thank you. Yeah. up the back. That's you. Yeah, totally, absolutely agree. When I retire, it'll be 70. That's the aim, for it to go to 70. That's a policy of the Liberal government. They've brought that in, and slowly it's come in over time. Yeah, anyone who works shift work, obviously, and there's so many studies that show that and the effect over time, and obviously anyone involved in any manual handling, like you all are too, about it not being possible. So that is absolutely part of the campaign. You can't have fairness if people have to work until they drop. Yeah. Well, we've got a big... Well, we've got a big problem with, because the superannuation system was really predicated on the fact that people would be in permanent jobs and be in permanent jobs all their life. And so there's two things happening. First of all, well, women are in the workforce much more than they were when it first came in, and they're the ones taking career breaks because they're having children, and we're not getting paid super on, when we're on maternity leave. And then also it affects the how much promotions or how much you move through the ranks because you're taking those career breaks. And so that needs to be fixed. So there's ways of doing that to make sure that women are getting extra super to compensate for it. The other thing, of course, that's happening is the amount of insecure work. So people are missing out on super because they're not hitting the like basic threshold for it to be paid. And the longer you're in that, the worse it becomes as well. So the average amount of money that women are retiring with so much less super than men for like these reasons. And so that system needs to be seriously reformed to make sure that no one retires in poverty, which was always something that we're for. It's interesting, every single group of people I speak to, someone asks that question. So no, but it just says what an important question it is really, doesn't it? So first of all, I think we've got to always remind ourselves, how did each of us get involved? And it was usually or nearly 95% always because someone asked you to. And so I think there's an obligation on the group of union delegates that are facing retirement or have been union delegates for a period of time to actively start mentoring the next generation, because quite often you see what happens is that a good representative will retire and there's a big gap, and that younger people will say, well, I'm not stepping into that job because the boots just look too big. But I see this really successfully happen at many different unions where they've gone about a mentoring program where they've some places where they've got a much bigger issue than you do. They've mandated it. They've said that everyone has to have a co-delegate, and that co-delegate has to be underneath this age. I'm not saying you should do that, but some unions do that as a means of consciously going about renewing the ranks. And they're not putting pressure on that younger person, so they might just go along to meetings and not say anything. They'll just listen to what's happening, and like over a period of time, you start developing the skills and developing your confidence over time as well. The other thing I think is really exciting is to see young people starting to fight back against what they've been told. So remember how I said they've been told that, look, it's just inevitable that there'll be insecure work. Another thing they've been told is, look, it's just inevitable that you're not going to be paid what the law says. When you start working in hospitality or retail, the usual entry-level jobs for young people, and that sort of like from the beginning, you've just got to get used to not even having your rights. And so slowly around the country, actually quite quickly when you think about it, groups of young people have started to get organised. There's a whole group of them in Victoria called Hospo Voice. Now there's a group in Sydney, and there's a group in Brisbane now too. And what they're doing is they're basically all networking online around how much they've been paid, and then they're organising to send letters of demand to the various little cafes that are ripping them off, and they're telling each other which ones are bad and which ones are good. Now, the ones that are fixing the thing, that's good, then they give them a big tick and all of that. The ones that aren't and refuse to pay the money, they organise protests out the front. And I've seen that happen like all over the place now. And what's happened, at least in Melbourne, I've seen it, is like send this ripple of fear through the employers who are thinking the problem for them is not the workers so much, but the reputational damage. Like people aren't going to go there anymore if they think that they're wage thieves. So what does that tell us? Sometimes it takes a group of people to start doing things to inspire people that it's not normal and that we can stand up to it and we can do something about it. So I think that's important. The other thing I've seen younger people start getting really engaged in is via social media, really creative ways of networking and sharing messages and doing so in a coordinated way as well. So there's little bits of things I'd say about that. Oh, it's definitely a Turnbull government, not a question about that. They not only won't change, well, Scott Morrison is the treasurer. So not only are they just not interested in changing the laws to make sure they pay properly, they are wanting to have them pay less because they believe in it. Like they believe in trickle-down economics. They actually think it'll be good if that happens. They'll have more money and then somehow all of us will rise up. But that, even though that's not happening, it's like they've got nothing else. And because it's something they've believed in all their lives and now it's sort of not turning out to be true, they don't have like, oh, here's plan B. They're just sticking with plan A all the time. So they're the ones we should focus on. In the end, the only other people who can become a government is the Labor Party. So we're also focused on their policies, getting them to adopt policies that will mean that we have a bigger tax base. And they have done a whole lot. I think they've probably got more to go in terms of what would need to happen to fix that problem. But they recognise what a serious problem it is. And the more we go on about it, as you know, the people go on about it, the more... And what I've learnt really is that they'll move when public opinion moves. So we don't sit back and watch. Our job is to move public opinion. And all of a sudden they'll say, oh, this is a popular thing. We think we'll do this. Last weekend was very important because... This is the by-elections we were talking about. So a lot was riding on that for both sides. And the campaign run by unions on the ground was about the tax cuts and about hospitals, really. And I don't know if any of you have been to Caboolture Hospital, but I've been there. It needs more funding. Absolutely, it does. And there's a whole demographic of people there that really depend on that hospital, and every single person knows through their day-to-day lived experience that that's where the money should be going to, not the banks and not that. And so I think it sort of says a bit about how out of touch that Turnbull government is, that they don't understand that the day-to-day experience of people is, you know, their hospitals being underfunded. And so the idea that we'd somehow just give all of this money to that on some wish that it's going to be better for all of us isn't washing, which I think is a really hopeful thing because, as I talked about before, for a long time that was just accepted a wisdom that we should do that, and now people are rejecting it. And so now I think the Turnbull government's going back and thinking about what they should do. And for 2 days there was sort of this internal talk. Of course, Tony Abbott was out there and all of that, saying that they should dump it. But I think that Turnbull and Scott Morrison are saying, no, we're sticking with it no matter what. I think they've probably made promises to those CEOs, those big companies, they're going to do it, so they will stick to it. Well, if they do, that gives us an opportunity to keep talking about why that's the wrong direction for our country to go in. All right, thank you.
I think we don't have time for that.
No problem.